I'm gonna go ahead and put another coat on because it you know, I brushed this out and I can already see, even on this humid day late in the evening, it's already dry enough for me to just go ahead and hit it again. So I'm gonna go ahead and get two coats on right now. Some people aren't used to being able to put a second coat on so easily, but Waterlox is so forgiving that it allows you to do it. So as soon as that previous coat gets tacky and starts drying, and it was, you can see here, can you show my hand? Uh-huh. See where, you can see where the ribbon stripe is here? That looks almost dry because that's almost ingrained. They just sucked straight down into it. And, you know, I can feel that. I mean, that's not even making a mark on the finish with me rubbing my plastic glove on there. That's practically dry, you know? We're so absorbed in that I can go ahead and just lay another coat down on top of it and just really get a good build on this first application. And you can't do this with varnish, no way. Varnish will do that alligator skin on you if you try to lay it on so heavy. I don't know what they do with this stuff, but it's magic. But what I love about this finish is just the low-tech quality of it. It gives you such a high-end looking finish. I mean, I've had people just gasp when they see my finished stuff. You know, I generally like to do about 7 coats. And I know it sounds like a lot if you're a polyurethane guy where you just want to do it all in one fell swoop, but I guarantee you there's no polyurethane that's going to look like this. And it's just not that much trouble to do such a pro finish. And then if you have to come back, if you have to get a glass ring out of it or out of the finish on somebody's piece of furniture, lightly scratch it, apply your coat again, and it just disappears. Little scratches just disappear. It makes you look good. But we want everything, you know, to be able to, this one-step process, and it's just, you know, that's just the kind of society we are. The other good thing about this is that this finish stays elastic almost indefinitely. So as the wood expands and contracts, this finish moves with it, unlike poly, which becomes rigid plastic. And that's why a lot of times you'll see when poly starts failing, it'll start failing by flaking off and getting a crackled appearance, because that means that the finish is so inelastic that it can't move with the moving piece of furniture, the moving wood. But old-time Yankee furniture makers, they know about this stuff. They also know about Waterlox as a paint conditioner, where they'll pour Waterlox into oil-based paint to give it a elastic finish for outdoors. The only problem with Waterlox, the first two that I mentioned, is that it has no UV inhibitors in it, so it's not acceptable for exterior applications or high UV applications. It will fail. But their marine finish, the 50% solids one, that's a pretty serious exterior finish. But even then, you still put this on first as a primer before you go, because that stuff is so thick that it won't penetrate down into the wood. You still put this on first because this will penetrate and mechanically bond with the wood fibers before you add the real thick stuff that lays on top and then UV protects the underlying finish and the wood. But just the low tech of it is what I love. I just don't want to be a slave to an HVLP or a spray room or the atomized particles in the air. You know, you spend more time cleaning up that mess than you do actually. If you just went ahead and did this, you'd be done with it, instead of all the time you do getting ready to spray, then the cleanup after the spraying, and you really can't apply that much material either spraying. I think there's something nice about a brushed hand brush finish. And I've used China bristle brushes a lot, but I like them, but they just, you know, they take so much thinner to properly clean your brush that I just think it's more environmentally sound to just use this than all that mineral spirits. These two boards came out of 1 8-quarter board that I resawed and laid it open. So each one is a book match of, is a book match. So I had 3 8-quarter boards that I resawed to make this panel. I'll talk about that later. I have a Hitachi resaw machine with a 3-inch blade, and it just does a real nice job economizing solid wood. I've had it for 20 years. I rarely buy 4-quarter material anymore unless it's just I know I'm gonna just cut it up into drawer parts or whatever. I almost always buy 8-quarter because I know I can then cut it down to any dimension I want really easily. Because a lot of times I need the 8-quarter stuff for furniture or whatever I'm building. But if I need something narrower, I just resaw it. So I do these. I'll trap the finished panels inside the door parts. And then I don't have to come back in and do anything but maybe just a little bit of touch up on these insides. Then I don't have to try to finish where the panel meets the door edge, which is always a pain and very hard to make it look really perfect. And I like it to look really good in those corners. So I just do this. And I can just really put the finish on the way I like it. So what I have it masked right here because I know that's where my door part's gonna come down, and that's where the glue needs to be for my mortise and tenon joint. So I'm getting ready to wrap it up for today. So I'm taking my cap off. And I got a little bit of finish left in here, so I'll just pour it back in. It's in a nice clean work pot. And then whatever the last little bit is in here, I always just saturate my rag, and then I go into my shop and I wipe it on my drawer parts, you know, on my shop cabinet doors. So I try not to waste any of it. So now I want to get all the air out of the can. So I just use a hand screw. And I've been crushing cans like this for over 20 years, and I've never had one break. So I just crush it until I see the level come all the way up to the top. I'm gonna tilt the can back a little bit to make sure that all the air is out. See that bubble just go out? It's right there at the top. Back it off just a skosh. Release the clamp, and you got a vacuum in there, so now there's no air in that can to oxidize the finish. So people come and they see my cans like this and they go, "Did you run over that can with your truck?" No. And they have a hard time wrapping their head around what I'm talking about because they're not, you know, they don't build and they're not spending $70 a gallon on finish. But some people do stuff like, I mean, I've read ridiculous tips like where people put marbles inside the cans to displace the air, and seems kind of crazy, you know. So yeah, you can see this you can crush it down to where there is less than, it's probably I don't know, 2/3 of a quart is you can crush it down. And then generally I will just use that last bit all in one fell swoop, or I'll just pour it into something else and use it up. Okay, let me go in and wipe this on some of my shop drawers.
It doesn't matter how dirty they are.
Nah, I don't care. They could use a freshen up. I don't care.
Keeps them last longer, huh? Makes them last longer.
Makes them shine. Come and help me. Oh, there's my boy. There's my boy. There's my boy.